period between the late 18th century and early 19th century was a period of cataclysmic changes in West Africa. And one major factor that led to this was the factor of the West African Jihad of the 19th century. And in today's video, we will be taking a look at the basic similarities or common factors in all three jihads. This is Past Future. VIP my squad, drop off all the game. VIP. A jihad, according to the dictionary, is a war fought on religious purposes. And with the name jihad, it is solely or mainly an Islamic war fought for the purpose of Islam. Now, this war could be for spiritual cleansing, or it could also be for political reasons, it could be for other reasons, but the bottom line is a jihad is a holy war fought by Muslims for the proclamation of Islam. It is pertinent to note that the first jihad was conducted by Uthman Danfodio in 1804. The second jihad was conducted by Sekou Ahmad, also known as Ahmad Barry, in 1819. And the third jihad was conducted by Alhaj Umar in 1854. The first thing to note about these three jihads is that all three jihads were for primarily religious purposes. For Uthman Danfodio, the jihad was for the purpose of the purification of Islam, of its paganism. And of the other two, which are Ahmad Barry and Alhaj Umar, they also had a religious tone. They also had a religious bottom line, which was to purify the state, to purify the land of its atrocities towards Islam, thereby pronouncing a holy war. A big similarity between these three jihads is that all three, like it or not, had political ambitions. And as a matter of fact, in one of the articles of Uthman Danfodio, he wrote about taking over a government as part of the obligations of the jihad. And looking over to Sekou Ahmad, he built a theocratic empire in Messina, as well took over other cities. All three jihadists, in the process of their Islamic war, did military expeditions over West Africa in their different times, of course, and they took over cities, they took over kingdoms, they took over even empires and made them their own. And if you look at Sekou Ahmad, one of the things he did was to install majority of his family into the government of his different subjects after the jihad. And if you look at Uthman Danfodio, after making the Sokoto Caliphate and taking over Borno, his son and his nephew were also rulers after the jihad. So bottom line is, all three jihads had political ambition, whereby they had it in mind to become emperors, to become kings over territories. A major feat in the three West African jihads of the 19th century is the aspect of economy, or economic aspect. It is majorly seen in the Uthman Danfodio jihad, whereby the Fulani cattle rearers needed to find a way to take control over the fertile grounds of the Hausa land. What was going on at that moment was that the Fulanis were grazing cattle on Hausa land, but were made to pay a lot of money, let me use money in quote, They paid tariff, they paid taxes in order to stay in that land. And so because of this, they needed to find a way to take control over that land so that they won't be able to pay this this amount of taxes and tolls, thereby joining the Uthmandan Fodio jihadi movement. And economic aspect could also be seen in Sekou Amadou and Alhaji Umar's jihad, in the aspect of military expeditions, where in all three jihads they conquered kingdoms, they conquered people, and because of this, the new emirates paid tributes to them, thereby gaining money, gaining resources through the jihad. Another big similarity between the three jihads of the 19th century in West Africa is the talk of tribalism. Tribalism was seen deeply in the Uthmandan Fodio jihad, because during the aftermath of the jihad, Uthmandan Fodio appointed 14 flag bearers who would be heads of the newly conquered emirates in West Africa. That was after the jihad. And of these 14 flag bearers, 13 of them were from Dan Fodio's tribe, which is the Fulani tribe. And this alone proves a lot or shows a lot about the talk of tribalism, as well as the fact that the Fulanis also had it in mind to find a way to remove every form of dominance of the Hausas in the northern part of Nigeria today and a few other parts of West Africa. And so with this, Uthmandan Fodio tried to find a way to make sure the Fulanis began to dominate. As I said earlier about political ambitions, this could also be seen as a political ambition and also as a tribal ambition. It could also be seen in Sekou Ahmad's jihad, because one of the aftermaths of Sekou Ahmad's jihad was the fact that he also appointed people from his homeland, Sangare, you know, to be high profile leaders in newly conquered empires, which he had conquered during the jihad. So tribalism is a major part of the jihad of the 19th century. The final point to note here is that of these three jihads, they had one common result, which were glaring victories. And looking at the Uthmandan Fodio jihad, the aftermath was the formation of the new Fulani Empire. Looking at Sekou Ahmad or Ahmad Bari's jihad, it led to the new formation of the Masina Empire, also known as the theocratic state of Masina. And also looking at Ahmad Bari, the aftermath of his jihad was the formation of a new empire as well, which took over from the Masina Empire of Sekou Ahmad. That's all for this video. If you learned something new about the jihad today, do well to hit the like button, subscribe. I'll catch you next time.